Good morning, everyone, and welcome. I greet you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. As we gather together, we've got lots of folks gone, birthdays and fans and friends and family all tying up and back to school and all that kind of stuff. So if you're here with us this morning, a special welcome to you. And if you're with us online, and again, welcome to you wherever you are watching. We're glad that you're able to connect with us this way. We know we have some folks who are very faithful, who are a part of things. So Michelle, if you're watching, good morning to you as well. We are simply a praying people, and so we begin our services very simply. That is, we pray. So take a moment to kind of look around the room, or as the Spirit grabs your attention, says, hey, you need to pray for that person or that moment. We know there is a lot going on in people's lives, so take a moment to do that. And then we'll pause silently to do that, and then I'll pray, kind of break the silence by a few short words. So let's pray. Father, in this dry and dusty land, we look down and we see the cracks of the soil and the dry earth beneath us. But this morning, we look up, lift our heads to heaven, and reminded once again of the rich and the goodness of your hand upon us in these days. And so we thank you. Lift our eyes this day for your glory, to your place of peace and joy, I pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. We had our rookie usher this morning, Corny. I want to thank him and take that order of service and just draw your attention to a few things as we start. Wednesday continues on here, both here and online, with prayer meeting and Bible study. Here in person and then on YouTube. And the next Sunday is kind of a basic Sunday school for all ages, then worship. September 23rd, Shelley Ladies Potluck Breakfast. Go, take it away. Good, thanks. Box of mini wheats and a quart of milk. Life is good.
Bring your toaster.
Bring your toaster, yeah. Or some maple candy bacon. Oh, that's men's ministry. October, you see a few things. Men, this is short notice, but if you're interested, we're going to do a flying trip to Wetaskiwin. We'll leave Friday after work. It's about 4.5 hours to get to Wetaskiwin. We'll pre-book some hotels. You can decide who you want your buddy to be. And then we're going to head. If we can get 12 men to go, then the Reynolds Museum does a special tour where they meet you ahead. They give you the white gloves, and then you can go and be a little more engaged with things. You can actually touch the Duesenberg. If you've never been to the Reynolds Museum, it is the world's Canada's second largest aviation museum, the oldest Chevy in existence, the oldest dragline excavator in existence, one of a handful of Duesenbergs, motorcycles, cars, snowmobiles. If it has wheels or wings, the one area is so big there's a DC-3 hanging from the ceiling, so that puts it in perspective. Or just look it up online. So if you'd like to go, we'll work out the details, but we'd love to get about a dozen guys, and then we'll go for the day, have supper, and then come home later on Saturday night. So I know it's short notice. That's the weekend after Thanksgiving. And then I've gone to Regina for ordination interviews. So you'll see a few upcoming things, but I'll trust you to read them there. Are there any announcements that I have forgotten?
Youth group next week.
Oh, sorry, I should put that in. I know, I'm sorry.
Youth group is every Friday.
Right, so what do you got going on?
This week we're doing street hockey, meet here at 7 o'clock on Friday night.
Okay, do you need gear?
If anybody has street hockey sticks they are willing to donate to the cause, please just drop them here.
Okay.
Anytime right. This week.
Okay, good. Anything else? All right, let's worship in song this morning. We have a new team this morning, very exciting.
Stand and join us this morning as we worship together our Lord. Okay, this one, are you ready? We're gonna do a round. Anybody over the age of 40 knows what that is. Anybody under the age, just pick somebody and sing with them. So let's split, oh, we're really kind of not. Okay, the outsides and the insides are gonna be separate. So everybody in the middle, follow Donna and Jackie. Everybody on the wings, follow Felicia and I. And so we wait, ready? Kid, we used to sing that in the round. I was convinced that at the end it was that we should be called the sons of Gus because God and us were always sung at the same time. So I was wondering who Gus was. But.
Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
It is my privilege each Sunday to take a moment to pray for you. Sorry. Father, in the darkness, in the worry, we look around the world and we see hurricanes and tornadoes and floods and changes around about us. And the changes unsettle us. Changes in our health, in our kids' lives, our communities. And yet this morning we gather in a place that in some ways has not changed. Unchanging truths, unchanging realities of your presence. So Father, this morning I pray for those who are undergoing changes, for those who are particularly facing health changes that have made their lives more difficult and they wonder about tomorrow, wondering when they can get into that doctor's appointment or if the medication this time is actually going to work. For little ones who are recovering, we thank you for little Hannah and the turnaround in her health and the strength that she has been given. Father, I pray for those who are changing. It's been a dry season and the harvest has been absolutely brutal. We ask that you would strengthen them. For Lil, as she recovers from her heart surgery, for each one. Father, we think of Courtney heading off to school and leaving his family at home for 7 weeks. That's a long time. That Krista would have strength to look after her little ones and that Courtney would learn well. Father, we think of the things we want to do, women's ministries and men's get together, club DJ, Sunday school. We bring all these things and we ask not for the God housekeeping seal of approval, but rather that we would be in your will, and we do. For Keith and Felicia and the Alcestors as they do youth group and reach into community, and our plans for partnership with the Lutheran Church for Club DJ, each one. Father, I pray this day that in all these and so much more, you would be the unchanging strength, a place of hope and courage, a place of an unchanging shadow, in a forever changing world. Now we thank you for the gifts that are given, the obedience that comes as we offer you these gifts in Jesus' name. Amen. I'll ask our ushers this morning to come forward.
Today's scripture is from James chapter 2, and read the whole chapter. Please stand with me for the reading of God's word. It reads, "My brothers, as believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, don't show favoritism. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in shabby clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing fine clothes and say, 'Here is a good seat for you,' but say to the poor man, 'You stand there or sit on the floor by my feet,' Have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my dear brothers. Has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised those who love him? But you have insulted the poor. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you? Are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? Are they not the ones who are slandering the noble name of him to whom you belong? If you really kept the royal law found in Scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing right. But if you show favoritism, you sin and are convicted by the law as a lawbreaker. For whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. For he who said, "Do not commit adultery," also said, "Do not murder." If you do not commit adultery, but do commit murder, you have become a lawbreaker. Speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law that gives freedom, because judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Thanks, you may be seated.
Except I'm going to ask you to stand up again. Up, down, up, down. Morning calisthenics, here we go. Beauty of Jesus, be seated. Kids, we have kids. I can see them. I can still see them.
Wyler, Cecilia.
We got kids, and we are going to sing a song about Jesus and how big his hands are. All right.
Thank you. Please be seated.
Two more things. First off, it's time for junior church. So if you are between before K, it's on that window, we've got things for you. And if you are between K and grade, where's Jackie? Six, that sounds good. You can go down with Jackie. If you want to keep your kids here, you're welcome to do that as well. Secondly, if you enjoyed singing, if you enjoyed hearing scripture reading, if you like this, we have nursing home service this afternoon. And my piano player, for the third time in a row, no mention, is gone. So right now, it is Don and I, Acapulco. So if you would love to come join us, I'll close my eyes, and join the nursing home choir, I would love to have you there. It's about a half an hour service or so, and the folks just really enjoy us being there. So if you could join us at the care home at 2:30, we'd love to have you there, and just sing along. Don has got the songs picked. No, she doesn't. We just sing off the book. So anyhow, that is there at 2:30. And if you want to bring your banjo, ukulele, harmonica, brass trumpet, whatever you play, mouse accord. No, there's no such thing as a mouse accord. But whatever it is you have, 2:30. Thank you. Mouth organ, harpsichord, mouse accord. Somebody once said, I'd love to spend 10 minutes inside your brain. I said, oh, no. God, you invite us into your heart and to your mind. We're reminded that the word says, for we have the mind of Christ. And I pray that you give me that this morning. Give each one of us the mind of Christ in a moment to see the truth of Christ so that we might live the life of Christ so that others would know the love of Christ. This we pray in his name. Amen. According to the U.S. Census Bureau, I take great delight in telling you this, horseback riding is more dangerous than motorcycling. Yes, it is. You are 3.5 times more likely to be injured riding a horse than you are a motorcycle. Horseback riding is the leading cause of sports-related traumatic brain injuries. Only 12% of all traumatic brain injuries are caused by skiing or snowboarding. 45% are caused by falling off a horse. 100,000 horse riding related incidents occur in the US every year. 1 in 10,000 people who rides a horse will be killed while riding, and 81% will be interested in that. If you want to know about horse falling off a horse, I encourage you to speak to Donna, who has got concussions, and anybody else who's ridden a horse. In Australia, you are 10 times as likely to be killed by a horse than a shark. So can you imagine going into a pasture and yelling, horse, get out of the pasture, right? We don't do that. They're incredibly dangerous animals. 83% of horse riding injuries are caused how? Falling off the horse. Is it any wonder then, in the spiritual realm, that our enemy wants us to lose balance and fall off the horse? And I'll explain what I mean by that in a moment. This fall, we're going to look at a book that I believe could help us stay on the course, stay centered in the truth, and that is the book of James. So take your Bible with me this morning and turn to the book of James. If you have your Bible, it'll kind of split two-thirds in the Old Testament, one-third in the New, and then you get about two-thirds of the way through the Old. You'll find that big book of Hebrews that Chris has been teaching us in Sunday school, and you'll find the little book of James. And I'll give you a moment to turn there. So about six-eighths through your Bible, if that works for you. The book of James begins simply to the 12 tribes who are dispersed. We have no idea who those people are. It could be a metaphor, it could be a literal, but that, despite that, we do have certainties about this book. It is written to people who have lost their way, who are facing challenges in their faith, and in particularly in their faith community, and are making mistakes, in effect, falling off the horse, and people are getting hurt. James was Søren Kierkegaard's favorite book, and Martin Luther's least favorite book. James, what we do know about him was that he was a leader of the church in Jerusalem around 40 to 60 AD, and we know this from Acts 12:17. We know that Jesus appeared to James. It says that in 1 Corinthians 15:7. He appears to James. So James has had a face-to-face encounter with Jesus. It was written in the middle of the first century, about 20 or 40 years after Jesus was raised and ascended to heaven. And it's rich in Old Testament images and pictures. So those are the things we know for sure. But before we take a dive into this, as we already have started, I need to explain and make sure we all understand what I mean when I say falling off the horse. What was happening is this community of faith, these people, were encountering events, ideas, experiences, people that was causing division and harm within the church. So they were, as it were, riding down the trail and they encountered an event. And rather than successfully either going through it or navigating it or going over it, they hit the brakes, as it were. We know that if you watch equestrian, when that horse hits the brakes, you can easily topple off. Or if you're going over a hurdle, the horse can twist. And Jordy was explaining to me yesterday how often the injuries are far greater because the horse goes up and you go up and your head smacks the ground. So they were encountering these moments. So he writes about these hurdles, these streams or logs on the path of life. He talks about temptation, money, the rich and the poor, judging others, true and false wisdom, the divided heart, the tongue, all these that can hurt and heal, true faith versus empty faith. And this congregation, like a horse coming to a fallen log or a stream, these were unexpected events, events they couldn't ignore or go around, and it startled them. And they didn't deal with it properly. And so they weren't handling it properly. And as a consequence, injury was happening in the life of the church. I hope this metaphor sticks with you. And so James addresses what we might say 14 hurdles. Think of like an equestrian event at Spruce Meadows. Or 14 stops along the way. And each one was a moment of risk where they might sway one way or the other. And so many times they fell off. It's a little book. 1,742 words long, and contained therein are 54 commands of how to deal with these. And the events they were encountering, they weren't doing it successfully, and people were getting hurt. So for one example that we'll look at, you know, he says, the tongue, if you handle it well, you can heal with it. That's the successful way across how to deal with your tongue. The unsuccessful way is you hurt people with it. Saying too much can be dangerous. Saying too little can be harmful. Either way, you fall off the horse. So I hope that metaphor lands with you this morning. And last week, Chris looked at the first hurdle that this church encountered. And that is, how do you deal with trials and difficulties? And we know that when we encounter a difficulty, there are successful, or we might say that, or unsuccessful ways of dealing with it. And Chris showed us that joy is the center post, the balancing point on the saddle. And we can fall off the horse by either reacting in despair or in denial. Both are incorrect ways of dealing with trials, where joy, and Chris elaborated on the nature of joy, is the way you stay in the saddle. So in the face of difficulty, you surmount, or you go over that or through that by having joy. Hey, joy in all things. So Chris introduced us to this idea last week. But before we do that, there's one more little piece I want to throw out there, and I want to talk about the reins. For this book, it's not one author speaking, it's actually two. Two guiding the truth through the book. And James is written by, I mean, technically three, all scripture is inspired by God. With the spirits at work, we don't want to deny that. But two human authors are engaged in writing this book. There's the visible one, we'll call that the right-hand rein, and the invisible one, the left-hand rein. The visible one is obviously James. But there is this unseen one, the one that taught James. Again, in Sunday school, Chris shared us that we all learn through someone else. So after all, where did James get his instructions? This seen and unseen authors, like two reins that guide us into truth and keep us on the path. The unseen author is Jesus. James' message is very close to the teachings of Jesus in Matthew. So if you look at the back side of your handout that our ushers handed out to you this morning, you'll see a list of coming messages and the connection between the book and the Gospel of Matthew. There's one from John in there, or sorry, Luke, but you'll see the connections. And each time James mounts, comes up to one of these hurdles, he takes his own understanding in one hand and the teachings of Jesus in the other, and these two, James' wisdom and Jesus' teaching, guide us through these hurdles. And so as we do this series, we'll be looking at the book of James, but then we'll see the echoes or the silent, unseen hand of Jesus in all these teachings. So much of James is an expansion or a complement or an echo of Jesus' teaching. So this morning, two reins will guide us, the words of James and the words of Jesus. All right, as we look at chapter 2, we're going to start out by looking at the obstacle they encountered, then how they fell off the horse, then the pain and the injury that caused the result of this, and then fourthly, how to stay in the saddle. So let's look at the hurdle, how they fell off, the pain that it was caused, and then how to stay in the saddle. Verses 1 and 2 give us the obstacle. And I'm not sure if it's a jumping over or a wading through, but we'll stick with either one works for your life better. What startled the horse? What issue was the church facing? Verses 1 and 2. My brothers and sisters, don't hold your faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ with an attitude of personal favoritism. And he illustrates what's happening in the church. For if a man comes into your assembly with a gold ring and is dressed in bright clothes, and a poor man in dirty clothes comes in. All right, what was the encounter? What was the hurdle or the log they faced? It was simply this: favoritism, distinction. The word literally means face-taking. We get that where we might say measuring something at face value, a surface approach to something, a biased judgment based on external circumstances. You can't look a gift horse in the mouth. Yesterday at the drag races, there was a Kia minivan. Yes, somebody brought a Kia minivan to a drag race. And we looked at it and said, this is useless. We were hoping that at some point he would flip a switch and it would go blah, 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 blah. It never did. It just went down the track really, really slow. At face value, you're thinking, that is useless. Well, it turned out it was. The next thing comes on, you go, that looks slow. And all of a sudden it goes blah, 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 blah. That's face value. A biased judgment based on external appearances. And so two people walk into church, as they do. There were the wealthy and the not wealthy. He uses the word lapros. Bright, shiny clothes. Clothes that capture the eye. Gold earrings, interesting, hey? It's the man who wears the gold ring. And he's bright and shiny. And the one in poor, dirty, shabby clothes. That's the obstacle. And so the church says, what do we do with the rich and the poor? You got to remember, this was countercultural for the day. In the world that this book is written to, rich people and poor people did not attend the same event. That was just forbidden. But also the church says, in Christ, there's neither male nor female, slave nor free, Greek nor Jew. Everybody's welcome. And the church says, okay, now what do we do with this? So what happened? How did they fall off? Let's take a look at verses 3 and 4. This is how they fell off. You pay special attention to the one wearing bright clothes. Say, sit here in the good place, and the poor man stand over there. Sit down at my footstool. Have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil motives? So here's how they handled the situation of the rich and the poor in the same church. They said to the rich person, here, you sit nice there. Remember the old days when the wealthy people had their pew and they sat in the good spots near the front. You got the, now the people who are, they sit at the back of the, no, it's reversed, right? But you come in and you offer the good bad. And you make the poor man his footstool, or say, sit at my feet. What's interesting to note is that in the time this was written, in the courts, in Jewish courts, both the accused and the defense wore the same outfit. That way the judge could not do face value. Whether you were poor or whether you're rich, you came into court wearing a robe, which today we have, if you've ever been to court, robes. Because the robe removes the distinction of rich and poor, so that the judge could judge without partiality. He couldn't look at face value, which is the opposite of what they were doing. And in doing so, they commit two sins. They fall off the horse. First, they make judgment about wealth. And they say that wealth and status are more important than the character of the individual. And in doing so, we'll see in a few minutes how they broke the Old Testament law. Secondly, he says, you have become judges with evil motives. That is, judges with vicious intentions. Their intentions, their actions, revealed their intentions. Their actions reveal their heart. This will be an issue that James will address time and again, that actions reveal the heart. And by catering to the wealthy, they were revealing what they thought about the poor. and what they thought about the wealthy. When you meet someone who's truly wealthy, how do you treat them? Versus that person on the street you know is not wealthy, how do you treat them? That reveals the nature of our heart. They revealed their soul. And James says, you have selfish motives. You are catering to that wealthy person so that you might in some way benefit from that relationship. As one author wrote, the saint that society ignores may be the believer that Satan can't. We don't know who we're dealing with. And so they came to the obstacle of the rich and poor, these two social classes in the same building, and they fell off in favor of the rich. They encountered an obstacle, and they fell off the horse. So what damage did it cause? What were the consequences to the body of Christ, to the life of the community? Well, 5-7 shows us the consequence of his action. And he shows us three injuries. Jordy read it for us, but let's read it again together. Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters. Did not God choose the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom? Exact same word he just saw, which he promised to those who love him. But you dishonor the poor man. Is it not the rich who oppress you and personally drag you into court? Don't they blaspheme the good name by which you were called? So herein he shows three injuries that occurred when you fall off. First year, Don and I were dating. I fell off a motorcycle, open face helmet, skid on the ground, and I walked in, and the side of my face was mostly seriously damaged. And the nurse looked at me, and she took that medicated curly cape, and she started scrubbing the asphalt, and she said, don't you cry, you did this to yourself. What injury occurs when we fall off the horse? Jordy, you want any horse injury stories? No, we'll leave it till later. These are the three injuries. First, they failed to see God's economy. They fail to see that in God's economy, the poor are of great value. It says God chose the poor of this world to be rich in faith. And they saw the economy of the world, which said wealth is good, poverty is bad. But in God's, he says, look, the poor are often the richest people in faith. I love what Abraham Lincoln said. God must love poor people because he made so many of them. First injury, it was an injury to the eyes. They injured their vision. They couldn't see what God was doing. Secondly, verse 6, they dishonored or downgraded or degraded those whom God honors. It says, you treat with contempt. What a terrible thing. You dishonor the poor man. You treat with contempt something that is actually beautiful. Have you ever witnessed someone treat with contempt that which is beautiful? I want you to imagine this morning that you have friends from Toronto that come to visit. And you say, we're going to cook steak. You've got your grill out, you've cleaned it up, you've got that beautiful piece of cow. You knew her by name. You know, it was not Sylvia, that's terrible, we know Sylvia, you know. Sorry, Shirley, that was my next shot. But cow number P49, you know, and you put that on there and you grill it to perfection, you turn it sideways, and it's just, you know, that little spot. How do you cook? You double kill your meat, right, you know. And you put it on the table, and then you just, like, salt and pepper like a tight t-shirt, just beautifully on there, you know, and you're ready to go, and they reach for the ketchup bottle. And you scream, and you say, don't dishonor the steak, because you're ruining what it's for. And it says, you dishonor, you degrade, you harm the poor. That's the word here. And then verse 7. So firstly, they fail to see God's honor. It's a damage to the eye. Secondly, they dishonor. Let's call it an injury to the tongue. And thirdly, verse 7. You treat with extraordinary kindness people who have no kindness for you and no love for God. They blaspheme the good name of Jesus. He says, is it not the rich who oppress you and drag you into court? You despise God's friends, the poor, and you honor his enemies. And this is so un-Jesus-like, so unlike Jesus. We see how Jesus encountered the rich and he encountered the poor. He treated them both the same. He treated them with equity. He showed no favoritism. Said both of them are poor and must come into the kingdom in their own way. They both must become like a little child. And Jesus had no regard for wealth or poverty. He said the poor are poor and the rich are poor. The poor are rich and the rich are both. Both had to enter the narrow gate. For the way is broad that leads to destruction. And so he says, if you honor the rich and curse the poor, if you treat people with distinctions that God doesn't have, if you let your own selfish motives govern how you treat people, and then he echoes Jesus. If you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Even the tax collectors do not do the same. And if you only greet your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Even the Gentiles, they do not do the same. James is echoing Matthew 5. All right, they encounter the rich and the poor. The horse goes down the trail, comes this moment. And they fall off into disregard, and they fall off into dishonor. How could they have stayed in the saddle? How could they have found balance and got through or over or around this obstacle, this social change that had occurred so dramatically in the church? The church is facing today social change. How are we going to encounter the social changes so that we don't fall off the horse and dishonor God, dishonor the marginalized, and love the rich? Both. Verse 8, if, however, you are fulfilling the royal law according to Scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You're doing well. But if you show partiality, there's the word again, you are committing sin and you are convicted by the law's violators. For whoever keeps the whole law yet stumbles in one point has become guilty of all. For he who said, don't commit adultery, also said, don't commit murder. And if you commit adultery but do murder, you broke the law. So speak and act as those who are judged by the law of freedom. For judgment will be merciless to those who show no mercy, for mercy triumphs over judgment. All right, let's see how they could have stayed in the saddle. First off, hold on to the royal law. That's what he says this moment of the royal law. Love your neighbor as yourself. What James is alluding to is Leviticus chapter 19, verses 15 and 18. Let me read them for you. Leviticus 19, verses 15 and 18. Here's the law they had broken. But you shall not do injustice in your judgment. You shall not show partiality to the poor, nor give preference to the great. Remember, this book is rich and in the Old Testament. He's quoting the Old Testament. But you are to judge your neighbor fairly. Verse 18, you shall not take vengeance nor hold a grudge against the sons of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. This royal law Paul alludes to in Galatians 6:2, bear one another's burdens and fulfill the law of Christ. So what was the royal law? Don't judge people by their wealth or their poverty. Don't show partiality, but love your neighbor as yourself. He says to them, hold on to the royal law. That will get through you. If you ever gone on a trail ride with people who haven't ridden a lot and they come to an obstacle, what do? They hold on to the horn, right? They'll take those reins and they'll hold them tight, but you can just see them. They're holding on to the horn for love or money, right? Because they don't want to fall off. Paul says, there's a law at the center. Treat your neighbor as yourself. That's the royal law. If you want the simplest way to get through this, do that. That's the bare minimum. Hold on to the royal law. He says, because remember, if you're going to try and follow the law, you're only going to break the law. You are falling off the horse because you have broken Leviticus 19. And falling off the horse is a good way to die. Remember, if you break the law at one point, you break all the laws. If you murder and adultery, it's the same thing, he says. It's all one big pot. And he uses murder and adultery. They're such big examples. They're so clear. Don't commit adultery, but if you murder, you're guilty. You show partiality to the poor and preference to the great and judge your neighbor unfairly, you've broken all the laws. And James says, lawless men were stealing dignity from the poor and giving it to the rich. They were anti-Robin Hoods. They stole from the poor and gave to the rich. He continues, if you want to get over this hurdle, at the very least, hold on to the horn of the law that is God's. But here's the way to do it. Verses 12 and 13 are a little confusing, so I want to read them twice. And my note here says, Dan, slow down. 12 and 13. So speak and so act as those who are to be judged by the law of freedom. For judgment will be merciless to the one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Let me read that again. So speak and so act as those who are to be judged, future tense, by the law of freedom. For judgment will be merciless to the one who has shown no mercy, for mercy triumphs over judgment. This is how we handle social inequality in the life of the church. This is how we handle the social issues of church. This is how we handle the poor. This is how we treat one another regardless of our status. Here is the Jesus way to cross the stream of cultural, economic, and social differences. You ready? How do you do this? Mercy. That's an easy word, isn't it? Mercy me. And James uses a unique word or image here. He says, judge by the law of freedom. Now, I don't know how your translation works, but he says, judged by the law of freedom. And without going into too much grammar here, I was reminded this week not to use words with many letters and syllables in them, and make sure you use simple language to explain things. And then I realized, this is something we all do. I was in a car yesterday, talking with this guy about welding. And he said, well, if you use the flogiston R32 and you butt it against the Eckstein valve, I'm going, what are you talking about, right? We had to stop, sort of, the Eckstein valve, maybe that works for you. And I realized that we all do this. We all have a language that we've mastered. And we can look it up in the book. So, if you're a grammarian here, this is for you. If you're not, I'll keep going through it. This is a genitive. And it's the genitive of. And what he's actually saying here is not the law that you, it is the law of freedom, it is the law of possession. It is the law that possesses freedom. So the genitive here is the sense of possession. That is, it is the house of Keith. It's Keith's house. And so the law of freedom here is the law, or the freedom, the law that belongs to freedom, the law that is in possession of it. And it's neat how this phrase came about. We've seen time and again that the New Testament is written in street language. And it often makes references to events in the culture that were common. People go, oh, I get that. But are uncommon to us. And so when James says the law of freedom, he's actually using a technical word that described an event that occurred. And people would go, ding, ding, ding. It's shorthand for something bigger. But for us to value the shorthand, we have to explain the bigger. Does that make sense? The phrase law of freedom or law for freedom came from how the Greeks would set free their slaves if they didn't want that slave to be purchased by someone else. So if you had a slave, you could sell him to someone else, but they would live the rest of their lives in slavery, and they could be sold again and again and again. So if you had a slave that you wanted to sell and set free, that you wanted, we call it manumission, setting free, you would sell it to the gods. You'd pick a god, and you would sell that god, slave to a god. The god, in effect, would purchase the slave. Now, since the slave didn't have the money, the master would provide the money and put it into the temple treasury on behalf of the slave, in the presence, and a document would be drawn up, and it would have the person's name, and it would say, sold for freedom, or sold into freedom. And therefore, no one could ever enslave that individual again, because they were sold to the God himself. Does this sound vaguely familiar? That we who are in sin, a price has been paid, and we are sold, as it were, to God, and now we are no longer slaves of sin, but slaves of righteousness. We have been sold, as it were, to God himself. He is our new master. This image that we sometimes maybe wrestle with was extraordinarily common in the language. And so James says, you are sold into freedom. You have been purchased, bought with a great price, not with silver or gold, but with the blood of Christ. And you are sold, he is now your master. It's a beautiful image. James is in effect saying that the wrong way to treat people is to put them under the old law. Besides, you can't keep it anyways. You're bound to break it in one way or the other, and if you fall off that horse, it's going to kill you. You will be guilty of the whole law. Here's the new way to get through this. Know that the master has paid a price, and you all, rich, poor, alike, male, female, Jew, Greek, whoever you are, all of you have been sold to God. No one can ever enslave you again. You are property. You see those t-shirts, God's property? That's exactly it. Sold, and you are his property. Now start acting like your master. The slave acts like the master. The daughter acts like her mother. The son like his father. We know how this works. And we who have been sold to God now must start acting like his servants. In the household of which you are now a slave, bought with a price, here, in this new household, the poor are of great value. Know what matters, what the master views as true wealth. Stop living like a slave to the old way and now live like you belong to God. And how do we live like that? How do we treat people? What do we do when someone walks in and we want to judge them and we think, well, you know, this is who they are, and that guy at the post office who kind of smells a little funny, how do I treat them? How do I, when I meet someone who is destitute or in need, what's my response supposed to be? How do we navigate this hurdle? Mercy. Mercy is how we navigate it. Mercy. We have some, I suspect everyone here this morning has a definition of mercy in your head, and we need to kind of slide that off to the side of your desk, because I need to insert the New Testament definition of mercy. So if for a moment by grace you could just put your definitions aside, I'm not asking you to destroy them, but just slide them onto the side of the desk and let me slide in the New Testament definition of mercy for us. The New Testament definition of mercy is simply this: it is out of compassion those who have give to those who don't. One more time. Out of compassion, those who have give to those who don't. This is more than generosity, for at its heart is a kindness seen through the desire to help those who are suffering and in need. This is the emotion we feel when we come into contact with someone who's suffering. I want you to imagine with me, use that sacred imagination, that you find a starving dog. The ribs are extended and the stomach has drawn up against the spine. The dog's back is arched, the tail is tucked under the leg, the head is low, the ears are down, and you know the look in the eye. This animal is starving. The emotion you're experiencing right now, if you're a compassionate person, that's mercy. If you could just grab that emotion for a heartbeat, what you've just experienced in your heart as you visualize that starving dog is you have experienced mercy. Because what do you want to do? I want to take that dog home and I'm going to feed it and make it healthy and I'm going to love it and hug it and hold it and call it Bobby, right? That's our feeling, because we want to save it from its suffering. That's what mercy is. Mercy is the emotional resonance from those who have much, who see that which does not have and want to save them or alleviate their suffering at the very least. I suspect many, many of you are merciful and you don't even know it. Think of the time when you were in need, miserable, and someone came along and out of their resources and strength helped you. It is said that while grace takes away the fault, mercy removes the misery. Imagine that time when you were stuck in the ditch and somebody came along and said, I'll pull you out. Or you had a flat tire and somebody said, I can fix that for you. Or that time you were grieving and someone came by and said, I have apple pie and coffee. Let's sit and grieve together. They were showing you mercy. When you lacked strength and someone gave you theirs. When you lacked joy and someone gave you theirs. When you lacked peace and someone gave you theirs. That's mercy. Out of their abundance, they saw you in your misery and gave to you. We have a bit of a false definition of mercy. We often say that grace is getting what you don't deserve and mercy is not getting what you do deserve. That's not a biblical definition. Mercy is getting what you can't get for yourself. Mercy is when you get what you can't get for yourself or when you give to someone who doesn't have. Does that make sense? That new definition? But I want to be careful here, and I want to be clear. Mercy is not incompatible with justice. We may think, well, justice is getting what you deserve. Mercy is not getting. The judge says, I'll be merciful to you. There's a way around that. And that is, mercy and justice are compatible. Matter of fact, justice itself is an act of mercy. If you have been treated unjustly, let's say you've been robbed, you don't have the strength to mete out justice, or in the case of something more grievous. You in of yourself have no tools. You are in need. And what does law enforcement and the courts do? They come along and they give you that which you cannot get for yourself. You can't get justice. And so the justice system and the courts, hopefully, and law enforcement, they give you what you need because you and yourself don't have power to get it for yourself. So justice is an act of mercy. And so if you're in the justice system, ironically, you're actually in the mercy system because you're providing that which you cannot do for yourself. Mercy is not incompatible with justice. All right, we chase that squirrel. And then he gives us a final warning. To those who would not show mercy, to those who would say, that is not the path across this hurdle. Come on, they're poor. It's just their weakness. They got themselves into this mess. Why should I help? Why should I, who have much, give to him who has none? Why should I be merciful? The NLT says this, there will be no mercy for those who have not shown mercy to others. But if you've been merciful, God will be merciful to you when he judges you. Phillips translates it this way, the one who makes no allowance for others will find none made for themselves. It's still true. Mercy smiles in the face of judgment. James now, one more time, echoes Jesus. Hear the words of Jesus in Matthew 18:32. This is a story of a man who owed money and he was collecting it, and the master found out that he had been cruelly collecting. The master calls the servant in. He says, you wicked servant, I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy? In other words, shouldn't you have given as I canceled the debt and gave to you, so should of you cancel that and give it to them. You should have had mercy on your fellow servants just as I had on you. And if you define mercy as giving to who doesn't have a need, it fits perfectly. In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. This is how my heavenly Father will treat you, unless you forgive your brothers and sisters from your heart. See, James is just echoing the words of Jesus. God in his mercy has freed you and I from slavery, so we too should be at work freeing others from slavery. Spend your strength to relieve the misery of others, for unforgiveness is a merciless act. How powerful is mercy? We think of mercy as a weak virtue, justice as a strong virtue. How powerful is mercy? I love this phrase. He says, mercy triumphs. This is a great word. For triumph means to laugh. And it's the image of a strong person laughing at the efforts of a weak person. Here's the image he puts forward. Judgment flexes its tiny muscles. It says, look how strong I am. I will crush you. Mercy strides into the room with a great smile on its face, removes its robes of humility, and laughs at the ridiculous tiny muscles of judgment. It flexes and says, look how strong I am. I will heal you. Mercy looks at judgment and says, you think judgment's powerful? Oh, you're crazy. Mercy triumphs, laughs in the face of the weakness of judgment. All right, let's draw this to a close. The people that this chapter encounters came to a hurdle, a social hurdle. How to handle the rich and the poor in the same place. They tried to navigate that by using judgment. They said it's good to cater to the wealthy and the powerful, and it's okay to neglect the weak. Splash. James says, splash. Wait a minute, don't the wealthy exploit you and drag you into court while you catering to them? Plash. You shall not do injustice in judgment. You shall not show partiality to the poor, nor give preference to the great. They fell off the horse, and the poor suffered, and the rich made them suffer. And James says, now here, hold on to this. Here's how you get across here. Remember, you are under the law of freedom. Start living like those who are slaves to freedom. Hold on with your big mercy muscles. Mercy triumphs. Mercy can feel unnatural to us. We are people of judgment and justice. We want justice. And mercy can often feel the least natural behavior. But mercy is the way across the hurdle. Someone said, it is the brave rider who trusts the strength of the horse to carry across the deep river. It is the brave person who trusts the strength of mercy to cross the great divide. John Gray was right. Cowards are cruel, but the brave love mercy. Let's pray. Father, thank you for all the time someone was merciful to us. When we were in our weakness, they strengthened us. They built our house for us. Gave us money when we needed it, cooked a meal when we didn't have one, comforted us in our sorrow, strengthened us in our weakness. were there in our hospital bed. We have all received mercy. And then we who could not reach up while we were dead, yet in our trespasses and sins, you sent your Son. And in the richness of heaven, you gave us the richness of Christ, so that we not, might not know the poverty of hell. You've given us mercy. This week, as we encounter people who are weary and tired, may we have the strength to help them, to be merciful to the weary, to the lonely, to the sick, to those who are sad. May we be people of mercy. May mercy triumph over justice. Amen. All right, I think we have a song. Afternoon. How's that for a plug? 2:30 at the Care Center. Coffee is at the back. We'll go from there. Please bow with me for the benediction. Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and this day give you peace. God bless you.